Good morning. Of course, everybody has to spread out, so I gotta do this all day. It'll be fun, though. Don't worry about it. So we had a little bit of break from the Book of Acts. Last week, we went through Easter and what that means. So we're going to do a little bit of review first thing this morning. We're going to talk about some history this morning. And then we're going to get into the meat of what we're going to talk about today. And the meat of what we're going to talk about is, why are we here? What's the point? What's the purpose? And not we as a Christian body, we as in us specifically. I'm going to move this thing around all day. You can laugh all you want. we're going to start our review in Acts chapter 7, verse 58. Anybody? Acts chapter 7, verse 58. We got to review a little bit. Acts is the other way. You getting there? We got some Bibles in the back if you don't have one. Leroy says she want to preach. Everybody ready? You want to go through 8:3, please? Go 7:58 through 8:3.
Then they cast him out of the city and stoned him. And the witness laid down their garments at the feet of a young man named Saul. And as they were stoning Stephen, he called out, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." And falling to his knees, he cried out with a loud voice, "Lord, do you not hold this sin against them?" And when he had said this, he fell asleep.
Yeah, 3:8:3.
I can't.
Which one?
8:1-3.
And Saul approved of his execution. And there arose on that day a great persecution against the church in Jerusalem. And they were all scattered throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria.
I can't pronounce that, sorry.
Don't worry about it.
The apostles, devout men, buried Stephen and made great lamentation over him. But Saul was ravaging the church and entering house after house. He dragged off men and women and committed them to prison.
Anybody want to take a stab at that? What does that mean? What was Saul doing to the church? You have no idea? Doing what? No. He was locking them up. So if you lived in Jerusalem and you decided that you wanted to follow Jesus, you would, bare minimum, you're getting locked up. Because it went against Jewish custom. That's not the way that the Jews saw was right, to be correct. So, jump forward to chapter 9. We've already seen the first martyr. And the first martyr was? We just read it. Stephen. Correct. So, Acts chapter 9. Chapter 9. We're going to start off right away. But Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues at Damascus, so that if he found any belonging to the way, men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. Breathing threats and murder. Anybody? What does that mean? Bare minimum. Nowhere in the scripture does it say that Saul actually killed somebody. But it does say that he condoned it. He said it was okay. He's the one that sent people to find them. He's asking the high priest, the president of the Jews, is the only way I could figure out how to put it, for papers saying that it's okay for him to do that. Why? Why does Saul think it's okay? He had not. But if you break it down to the Jewish law, Saul thought he was doing what God told him to do. If you go back to the Torah, the first five books of the Bible, and look at the Jewish law, this is exactly what he's supposed to do. To break that down a little bit, Saul's about 30, okay? He was born in this tiny little town in what's modern-day Turkey. He was born to Jewish parents who were Roman citizens, which meant that either they were born to Roman citizens or they paid a ridiculous amount of money to be the upper top class. It doesn't get any better. So when he's 12, maybe 13, they send him to this rabbi of a man that I cannot pronounce, and I'm not even going to try. They sent him to the Jewish school, and he learned how to become a Pharisee. And what that means is that if we could pop Saul up right now, he could quote the anything in the first five books of the Bible. He knew that off the top of his head. That blows my mind. I can't remember what I had for breakfast yesterday. And Saul can just... And he knew it. Not only did he know it, he loved it. And he lived it. That's the life that he had to live. He thought he was doing God's will. Thank you, little brother. Can you say that a little louder, please?
He had to be pretty dedicated.
He did have to be pretty dedicated. So dedicated, in fact, that Saul could come into this room and command someone to be stoned to death. And the rest of us would go, okay. And we pick up rocks. And when it says that they, in chapter 8, the first three verses, it says that they laid their coats at the feet of a young man named Saul. Tamika had a great breakdown of this. When you're a parent at a sport game and your kids forget to take the necklace off or something. When I was a kid, and we would fight in the parking lot at the park, it would, man, take this, hold my butt. And that's exactly what they did. Because Saul gave them permission. The power that I can't even fathom, but he makes sure that Stephen becomes the first martyr. Martyr means someone that is killed for their faith. Back to chapter 8, verse 3. It says, you don't have to flip, don't worry about it. Not only did he seek out letters to imprison the men, who else? Women. I can name, off the top of my head, three times in the New Testament that we talk about women. Because in Jewish culture, at this time, women meant nothing. They were no one. There was no equality. They weren't counted as citizens. Women and children were nothing. But he still was so enthralled in his job. He did such a good job that not only am I going to lock up the men, the people that are going around to the house churches, and I'm going to lock up everybody. I'm going to kill them all. And he thought he was doing God's will. It doesn't say how long they did that. But he was doing it for a minute because everybody knew him. When we get to chapter 9, it starts off with, but Saul. Not but God, but Saul. Still breathing threats and murder. When I hear that, I had to look this up because I needed to know what that meant. Still breathing threats and murder. That meant that this wasn't just his job. This isn't just what somebody above him made him do. This is his life. He loved what he did. Some translations say he was making havoc or trying to destroy, but that he wasn't trying to do anything. It was the very breath that he breathed meant destruction for the church, for the way, which is what the early Christians called themselves, because Christ called himself the way, the truth, and the life. So Saul is doing what he believes he was taught from a young age. This is what Pharisees did. This is, we have to destroy everything that isn't us. One of the main reasons that I think can, who's got a Bible ready? Are you ready? Deuteronomy 21, verse 23. This is one of the main reasons that I think, 21, 23, that Saul thought that he was doing God's will. 21, verse 23.
Can we read it?
Yes, ma'am.
Can we read 22?
Yes, please. Context.
A man guilty of capital offense is put to death and his body is hung on a tree. You must not leave his body on the tree overnight. Be sure to bury him that same day, because anyone who is hung on a tree is under God's curse. You must not desecrate the land of the Lord your God is giving you as an inheritance.
Did everybody hear that? No, I think you did a great job. What that said, the main chunk that I wanted you to hear was, anyone who is hung on a tree is under God's curse. You can't even bury them in the same place that you bury everybody else. So Saul, not only has he been taught from a young age that this is how we live, he also knows in verse 23 of Deuteronomy 21 that anyone that's hung on a tree is cursed by God. And Christ was hung on a tree. According to Jewish law, he was cursed by God. So Saul, all this teaching that he's got, he can name say scripture off the top of his head for anything, for any offense, for any law. And there's a ridiculous amount of law. He knows that what these people are doing is wrong. So let's get rid of them. How many times have you known that what you were doing was right? Every day. I think I'm right every day. Ask my wife. She'd tell you all about it. I was wrong once, and it was a bris fall day in November 1987. But if God showed up today and told you that the way you were living your life is wrong, what would you say? Excuse me. I know what I'm doing. I'm providing for my family. I'm raising my kids the way that I was taught to raise my kids. I'm doing everything right. Until you're not. Saul's, I want to say vehemence. Does everybody know what vehemence means? Passionate anger. I love that woman. Saul's passionate anger about what he was doing not only comes from everything that he knows, it comes from everything that he feels. Because he was present at the stoning of Stephen. There are some scholars that say that he was present at the trial of Stephen. So he got to hear just a couple chapters ago when Stephen snapped and went off on everybody and told them exactly what they was doing. Right? So if the way is right, if Christianity is right, then everything that he believed, everything that he worked for his entire life was wrong. And how many men in here can say that after 30 some odd years, somebody can tell you everything that you know is wrong and you're going to go, okay. Ain't a man bad enough. Tell me. I wish he would try. Come to the house and say that in front of my wife and kids. I got plenty of windows. You can go out of all of them. You can't tell me. Does anybody relate? Okay. One of them did. All right. We got one person. We're good. Yeah. Who wants to do 3 through 9 for me? Go ahead. How about you can take 3 through 5 and you can take 6 through 9.
On chapter 9 or chapter 8?
Chapter 9, ma'am.
Okay.
You said 6 through 8 for
me? Go ahead.
3 through 6?
Yes, ma'am.
As he neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice say to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" "Who are you, Lord?" Saul asked. "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting," he replied. "Now get up and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do."
So he, trembling and astonished, said, "Lord, what do you want me to do?" Then the Lord said to him, "Arise and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do." And the men who journeyed with him stood speechless, hearing a voice, but seeing no one. Then Saul arose from the ground, and when his eyes were opened, he saw no one. But they led him by the hand and brought him into, what's that called?
Damascus. Yep.
And he was 3 days without sight, and neither ate nor drank.
Okay, so let's back up and let's just tackle verse 3 for right now. Now, as he went on his way, he approached Damascus, and suddenly a light from heaven shone around him. He's walking from Jerusalem. And Krista and I sat down yesterday. We had to Google how far. It's 150 miles from Jerusalem to Damascus. So you can go, where is it? You can go to Spencer. I'll drop you off. And then you walk to Council Bluffs.
Say that again.
You can go to Spencer.
Okay.
Walk to Council Bluffs.
Council Bluffs.
You know where Omaha's at?
Oh.
Walk to Omaha.
It's like 3 miles from Omaha.
Walk to Omaha. Saul did. Saul and his whole crew that was going to take care of all of the Christians, all the people following the way to Damascus. 150 miles. We walk.
And people followed him.
People followed him carrying stuff. So we're going to walk. We walk about 3.1 miles per hour, an average man, not carrying nothing, just 3.1 miles an hour. At 10 hours a day, he's walking for 5 straight days. This is how passionate he is about what he's doing. It take 5 days.
To walk to Omaha.
Because you walk.
At a steady pace.
I'm good.
For 10 hours.
No. I can't think of anything besides, okay, Corbin, I love you. I'm not walking to Council Bluffs because my boy wants me to. I love him to death, but, ooh. A something, right? So, and this is how we know that he's walking. Okay, let's look at verse 4. And falling to the ground, he heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" Jump down to verse 7. The men who were traveling with him stood speechless, hearing the voice, but seeing no one. Didn't say anything about Saul fell off a horse. Saul fell off a camel or out the back of a chariot. Didn't say anything about the people that he was with. They just was walking to Council Bluffs. That's ridiculous. How much passion, I don't, the passion you have to have. Moving on.
But they didn't know
that. They, not yet. Not yet they didn't. And he said in verse 5, "Who are you, Lord?" And he said, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting." Did he say, "I am the church of Christ, which you are," did he say, "I am the way that you know you're persecuting. I had to say that one for Joe because I always tell him when he messes up. Persecuting me. You're destroying me. Christ takes this personally. God himself takes this personally. How bad you got to mess up? But rise and enter the city, and you'll be told what you are to do. The men who were traveling with him stood speechless, hearing the voice, but seeing no one. So Saul got up, his eyes were open, saw nothing. His eyes were covered with something like scales. We don't know what it was for sure, but God closed his eyes. Okay? They say that the light that God chose to use was something like lightning. And if you stare at lightning for long enough, the physical reaction is there. So this very well, this is not outside the realm of possibility. He saw nothing. So they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus, which says that he was almost there already. He's just a few miles outside of town. He's ready to go. They're getting excited. They're getting the chains out. And for 3 days, he was without sight and neither ate nor drank. Now comes the hard question. God, in his all-powerful wisdom, could have and smitten him, and saw what had been done. There'd been no more persecution for the church. I said smitten.
Smitten means in love.
Smoten. He could have smoten something. Smited. One of them. You know what I mean, though? All right, good. We know what we're talking about. So for 3 days, he didn't eat or drink. Here comes the question, are we ready? What did Saul do to deserve the second chance? Don't worry. I'll wait. So he's out there. He's killing people. He's sentencing people to their death. He's sending people to prison for nothing other than believing what they believe. You guys ever heard of that before? You never heard of a religion telling another religion that they can't exist? What? That's happening right now. Today. There are Christians being persecuted because somebody thinks they're doing it better. Saddam Hussein did it. Hitler did it. Where's their second chance? They didn't get one. I know, right? But Saul did. What did he do to deserve that? Nothing. God's grace gave him that. I was 33 years old before I really figured that out. You know how many people I beat because they were different than me? For no other reason. 5 years I've done in the Iowa Penitentiary because I like hurting people. I'm good at it. I wish, I don't wish. Ooh-wee. Some people here today can tell you stories about what I used to do. Saul and I had a lot in common. I like to say I was just as good at my job as he was at his. But the grace of God. Nothing else. The grace of God. My parents didn't do it for me. They were my biggest cheerleaders. Ooh, Chucky did it again. They used to call me Chucky, but y'all didn't know. It's cute though, huh? Yeah. Why did Jesus, in his marvelous grace, pursue Saul? It was not because he was a Jew. It was not because he was a Pharisee. It was not because he was a willing participant in the stoning of Stephen. It was not because of the blasphemous things that he said about Christ. It was not because of his persecution of the Christians. It was not because of his attempt to destroy Christianity as a whole. Saul's greatest problem was he thought religion was going to save him. With all of this religion, he was still a lost sinner in need of a Savior. Any of those? In need of a Savior? Understand this. If you have not accepted Christ into your heart, you are just as guilty as Saul. No more, no less. You're just as guilty. And if you die without Jesus, you will quickly find that religion is not enough. The only thing that is enough is a personal, daily, dedicated relationship with Jesus Christ. Verse 10. Who wants to start in verse 10? Okay, thank you. Go to 13 for me, please.
Now there was a believer in
Damascus.
Ananias, the Lord spoke to him in the vision, saying, Ananias. Yes, Lord, he replied. The Lord said, go over to Straight Street to the house of Judas. When you arrive, ask for Saul of Tarsus. He is praying to me right now. I have shown him a vision of a man named Ananias coming and laying his hand on him so that he can see again. The Lord exclaimed, Ananias, I've heard about the terrible things this man has done to the believers in Jerusalem. And we hear that he is authorized by the leading priest to arrest every believer in Damascus.
So here's the second time in just a few verses in this chapter that the Lord has appeared to someone else in a vision. The difference is, Ananias, here I am. And what's he say next? Lord tells him to go. There's this guy named Saul. Maybe you heard of him. And Ananias had heard of him. And what does Ananias do? Wait a minute. Wait a minute, God. Maybe you didn't know, but this man out here killing folks, he's trying to tell God what God already knows. Maybe you could send my brother, he's not doing nothing. If you could send him, maybe next time you need something done, I can come. And we're, no. You're just laying there, right? And God shows up and you, I don't wanna. Starting in verse 15, but the Lord said to him, go, for he's a chosen instrument of mine to carry my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. For I will show him, you ready? For I will show him how much he must suffer for the sake of my name. Maybe you thought that this life was easy. Maybe you thought that what we do, you accept Christ, right? And then you get baptized. And then you pay your 10% to the church. And then everything's okay, right? Not even close. God tells us right here that we're about to suffer. Saul suffers, we suffer. Every day, we have to sacrifice something else. Ananias is pleading with God. How much evil Saul has done in your name, has done to your saints at Jerusalem, which is still 150 miles away. There's no television, there's no newspaper, there's no interweb, there's no nothing, but still, a 5 days walk, we know what Saul's doing. We're scared. Because not only do we know what he's doing, not only have we heard of what he's doing, we know it's true. Again, I will ask you, why was Saul converted? Why did Christ pursue him? Christ pursued Saul for you. For me, for Pastor Joe, for Adrian, for the babies. That's why. This isn't in the word, but let me ask you, how easy is it to forget or to not take advice from as parents, somebody who's never had a baby before? It's hard. You know, sit down and not a, I don't care what you say. You don't know what you're talking about. Does Saul know what it means to be a sinner? As soon as he's struck, it says in the text, man, he does nothing for 3 days. Nothing. He doesn't eat, he doesn't drink, he doesn't sleep, nothing. Except reflect on everything I've done. How much time have you spent reflecting at the end of the day just on what you messed up today? Skip 30 some odd years. You ever lay there and go, crap, I shouldn't have said that. I wonder if that's a sin. Is that a sin? Probably. On today, I'm going to believe the person that's got some experience in what I'm talking about. When I went to prison, I couldn't ask the guys that were in there for drugs any advice about anything. Because you know why? None of them did it. You seen Shawshank Redemption? Mm-hmm. Lawyer did it. My old lady set me up. Nobody did it. Nobody, me. I admitted everything I did because I was ashamed. Nobody told on me. I told on myself, matter of fact. That's a different story that we don't tell in church. I'm going to believe the man with experience. So, in Galatians chapter 1, verses 15 and 16, Saul, who's then converted, says, I am the foremost of sinners, but I receive mercy for this reason, that in me, as the foremost, Jesus Christ might display his perfect patience. Literally means that the whole of his long suffering for an example to those who were to believe in him for eternal life. For us, for you and me, that's why he went through all of this. In this passage, and while Saul is just, he's on his knees in reflection and prayer, he never once in any of the scripture, and Paul wrote much of what's to come after this. Not one time did he say that his conversion was linked to anything that he did before that day. He wasn't prepping for nothing. The single worst phrase that I've ever heard in a church building is, I'm going to get me some Jesus as soon as I get right. More personally, it's when God wants me to slow down, he'll slow me down. Saul was on his way to kill as many Christians as he possibly could. And Christ chose him. I've done some disgusting things in my life. There are people in this world that will never be the same because of something I did. And God chose me. All of the garbage that you've done in your life, all of the mess that you've had to clean up, God chose you. If he can convert what Saul himself calls the foremost of sinners, let me hear how bad you are. Let me hear how terrible you've been in your life. Because that's nothing. It's nothing. God will tell me when it's time. When I'm ready, I'll just... There's only one perfect time to ask Christ into your heart. Anybody want to take a stab at it? Right now. if God could close the mouths of the lions for Daniel, if he could part the Red Sea for Moses, make the sun stand still for Joshua. I got this from Facebook. Y'all should check it out. Open the door of the prison for Peter, or put baby in the arms of Sarah, or raise Lazarus from the dead. What are you worried about? What are you waiting for? Ananias departed, verse 17, and entered the house. He showed up. Hi. God told me to come chat with you for a minute. Laying his hands on him, he said, Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road by which you came, has sent me that you may regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit. And immediately, something like scales fell from his eyes, and he regained his sight, and he rose and was baptized. And taking food, he was strengthened. So Ananias shows up. Okay? It's been 3 long days. Not being able to see. He's not talking. He's not trying to find a cure. He's just on his knees in prayer and reflect. I see him on his knees. It doesn't say that in the scripture, so don't get messed up. What's the first thing he does? Does he eat? Does he go to the bathroom? Baptized. Right now. And then he eats. And then he drinks. What's the first thing you would do? It'd be some crying involved, I think, yeah. But be baptized isn't on my top 10 list.
Thank you.
I'm hungry. Good job, little brother. Better man than me. I'm hungry. Thirsty. I have to use the restroom right now. Something. And immediately, he rose, was baptized. His life starts now. Right now. Let's make this happen. Remember the Ethiopian Miss Tamika told us about? There's water right there. What are we waiting for? What's the holdup? What are you waiting for? When was the last time that you know you were called by God? When was the last time that somebody said something that you knew was aimed at you? I've sat at the back table, I don't know how many times, wondering if Joe was preaching at me. When was the last time you listened? When was the last time that you did what he asked you to do? It's uncomfortable, isn't it? You know how many times I've said no to God? I can't count that high. And I'm pretty smart. You gotta stop saying no to God, man. He's only gonna sit you down so many times. You're only gonna have your Damascus road so many times. You know what your sin is. You know what's keeping you apart from God. It is your choice every single day to not get closer, because that's all he wants, is to have you right here. Are you going to stop saying no? What do we do next? Head, heart, hands, Joe? Yeah. So, head, heart, hands means, what, if anything, did God say to you today? If you want to write it down, if you don't, fine. I don't remember what the rest of it is. Joe's going to take care of this next part.